Breakfast in Barbados.
Good morning and welcome to Breakfast in Barbados. And we are at Cocktail Kitchen, the brand new restaurant right here located in St. Lawrence Gap. And I am with Chef Damian Leach. Look, he has a story to tell us today. Caribbean Chef of the Year at Taste of the Caribbean. So Damian, first of all, congratulations to you.
Thank you.
Right. And you're going to tell us all about your fabulous new restaurant. But first, I want to know about this Damian Leach. He's 100% Bajan. I needed to make sure of that first. Okay? 100% Bajan. He's representing, celebrating our 50th. I love it. So Damian, tell me a little bit about you growing up in Barbados. Before we get to this whole chef thing, tell me about your childhood basically here in Barbados.
Well, my childhood was, you know, it was normal, minus the, I didn't have a cell phone, obviously. Mm-hmm. I ain't that young. Well, you know, I had a good childhood. I had a lot of friends. It was a cool place growing up.
Where did you go to school? Primary school, secondary school?
Primary school, I went to St. Gabriel's.
There was something I remembered about your face. I know.
And then I went to St. Michael's after that. And then I did Palmery. I did culinary arts associate degree, and then I went to Canada.
Okay. So when you were a little guy running around St. Gabriel's, did you ever play war at St. Gabriel's though? You know about the war and playing in the woods and stuff? Or you little
woods,
too young
yeah,
for that?
In the woods, yeah, for sure. In the woods, yeah.
You never used to
I
do the
war
thing?
I can't remember war.
War was in my time, right? Every lunchtime, you're in the woods warring against another team. But you're a little younger than I am, so.
Yeah.
It was a tradition. Those of us who went to St. Gabriel's, we had to. The woods was
the
definitely.
Woods, the woods was. The woods.
And the, what's those things? Mahogany pods and
correct,
all those kind
correct.
Of things.
And then the helicopters.
Yes. You see, I had a feeling. I just had this connection. When you were running around as a young man at St. Gabriel's or even in secondary school, were you ever thinking about food and besides eating it?
No, in primary school, I was just studying nuggets. Nuggets was my thing because I could have gotten them cooked and it was, I love them to this day. Mm-hmm. Secondary school, when I actually started to think that I want to become a chef, I was in second form or third form. I was actually doing art. It's either you do art or food and nutrition. Mm-hmm. And I did art, but I got kicked out of art.
Why, were you terrible at art?
I was terrible at school, right? So the teacher had enough of me and me and another fellow said, you know, get out. So mm-hmm. I said, all right, cool. The yearhead said, well, you can't just be out here leaving. You got to do something so I can put you in food and nutrition. Mm-hmm. Then I went in food and nutrition and I fell in love with it. From the time I went in food and nutrition, I knew I wanted to be a chef.
Was it because of the actual process of learning about food or was it maybe a teacher that made you fall in love with the whole idea of food?
I can't really like point out exactly what it is, but I just fell in love with it and I knew that that's what I wanted to be. Before, I didn't have a clue if I was going to school, but that from that time, I knew I wanted to be a chef and there was nothing else that I wanted to be.
I happen to have a little background information on you though, in particular your father.
My father?
Yeah.
Okay.
So I understand that your father was in food and that sort of thing as well?
My father was not into food. He used to work at Caribbean Liver Craft. Mm-hmm. Then he stopped with that and then he started to do some food. So he sells burgers and that kind of thing. Oh, with courtesy. He makes a really good chili burger and a lemonade, but that's his thing. He always thinks that his burgers are way better than anything I can make. That's how he is.
Well,
it's not true. It's not true.
I had a fish burger from him. I had a fish sandwich from him. It was really good, and that lemonade is on.
Nah, he does a good thing over there.
Oh, so y'all kind of still got the burger rivalry going on?
Oh yeah, no, for sure. For sure.
Okay, let me talk about you coming out of secondary school then and you falling in love with this whole cooking thing. You got kicked out of art and then you got sent into food and nutrition. Then something clicked. So you finished secondary school now. Mm. Where do you go from there?
Palmery.
Okay. What did you do at Palmery?
Actually, I tried to do the associate's degree at Palmery, but I didn't get in.
Okay.
They had no space because obviously they take the ones with a lot of CXCs and mm-hmm. I was playing the fool at school, you know. Mm-hmm. I had enough, but other people had more. Mm-hmm. So I didn't. So then Miss Earl said, well, I can try and get in general catering. So I did general catering mm-hmm. for a year and I was the top of that class. And then automatically went on to the associate degree after that, top of that class again.
That's pretty impressive for someone who says, you know, I played the fool at school, wasn't really interested, da da da. Then you find your love.
That's it.
Head on to Palmarina. You're the top of your class in the courses that you do take. What are those courses? What do they look like, you know, when you went in and you had to take food and nutrition to the next level? You know, what kind of things did you learn that were new to you and fresh and different?
At Pommery? Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, that one would be more cooking on, maybe getting knife skills, because they wouldn't necessarily have the knife skills at food nutrition at school, you know? But then the knife skills and the fabricating of the meats and then more hands-on stuff, you know?
Okay. So from Pomerine, what was the next step for you?
I went overseas. I went to Ottawa at Le Cordon Bleu. Mm-hmm. And I did all three levels of cuisine and pastry, because I wanted to be able to do anything, mm-hmm. at all. So I did that, and then I stayed on up there. I worked for a year, mm-hmm. and then I came back home.
Coming from Pomerine and going to school in Canada, the teaching system or the way they taught things, what were some of the major differences you found?
The major difference out there is actually the produce that we get to work with. Because that, so much things, beautiful things that we won't actually get here. I mean, down here is, you know, it's basic stuff, you know, sweet potatoes. And it's Pomerine, you know. Mm-hmm. Don't really have that big of a budget to have all these things for me to work with. So up there, it opened my eyes to a lot of things.
So your eyes are open to things outside, but what about you coming as a young Bajan, passionate about food? You're going to Canada, they're teaching you things, but were you able to take anything that's unique about us here to Canada and say, look, we do this or we eat this or whatever? Even, well, obviously you're a student, so you can't control, but were you able to take any of your Bajan side to Canada?
Honestly, I'm sad to say it, but no, I didn't take anything, because up there I was just about learning. I wasn't about kind of bringing anything. I was just taking in everything at that moment. I wasn't ready to give anything. I was just taking in everything I could.
If you had to pinpoint like one of the things that you learned, your best experience learning-wise in Canada, what was it?
My best experience learning-wise.
That you still probably practice today, or it stays with you?
Probably a good stock, to be honest. Something as basic as that. Mm-hmm. But I mean, the stock is where it starts, and then from everything else it goes, you know. But up there, because it was a French school, so it was a very classic stock, rich, you know, not just like chicken bones, you know. It was, so that's a big part of what I do every day.
Okay. Now you finish school in Canada, mm-hmm. and you go off to work for a year. Talk me through that experience.
I worked with a chef called Mark Lapine, and he was crazy. He was very into the molecular gastronomy at the time. It was coming. It was new then, and he was playing with liquid nitrogen every day and doing seared tunas from the inside out with weird tools, and he was a lot of fun.
Molecular gastronomy. I've seen some of these things, and you're thinking, can you actually eat it when you're done?
Yeah.
But it looks amazing.
It does look amazing. I mean, it changes the textures, everything, and this is... It was really cool. I was hooked on it up there because of him. Mm-hmm. When it came out, I was like, that's all I was studying. But that was, what, 10, 11 years ago, and I didn't... Barbados, I don't think, would have been... Nobody didn't want to eat a foam or, you know, spherification or powder or anything. They were like,
we're still pretty traditional in the way that we like our foods prepared. But I would ask you, do you find that we're changing as it relates to how we look at food, or the fact that we are now looking at food?
I think so. And a lot of chefs down here are now taking on these techniques that you see all over the world now. So the chefs down here have really upped their game, I think. And the people are seeing that a lot.
Okay. What made you come back home after a year? It was a year you worked in Canada after you finished school.
Yeah.
What made you decide to come back home?
I missed home, to be honest. Mm-hmm. I wanted to come back, and I said, you know, I got this big certificate of it, you know, like come back home and land this big job. That didn't work out that way.
What happened? happened when you got home?
Yeah, I just got a job. I came out and I had a job at the Cliff. Mm-hmm. I worked at the Cliff. Which is what I wanted, because when at that time I came out home, I said the Cliff was a mighty restaurant.
Well,
you know?
I was like,
so let me land that. Mm-hmm. So I came out and I had got that the next week that I landed. I had a job there.
Okay, what about your experiences then? You had this wonderful experience in Canada for a year, learning techniques that were just over the top. Mm-hmm. It's like food and science boom coming together. You come back home now after a year, and you go and you work in a restaurant. What position did you have at the restaurant?
I was just a chef of party. Mm-hmm. Just, but My problem with the cliff is I stayed on that position for 3 years, and I wanted to move. I wanted to do something different. So coming to work and doing the same thing every day, and their menu doesn't change. I'm not gonna put down Cliff. Cliff is a fantastic restaurant, you know, but I just needed something more. With my coming from my chef out there who was changing the menu like every month, he got these different things and then come out and they got a menu that just running. I don't like that.
Okay. So in your head, what were you thinking at that time? What did you want to do, Damian Leach, as a chef? Where did you see yourself going?
Somewhere else. Which happened. I went somewhere else. Somewhere that I could go and I could, you know, be creative, be given an opportunity, you know. Mm-hmm. Not saying I can come in a place and take over the whole menu, but if I have an idea and I go to the chef, you know, what do you think about this, you know? Mm-hmm. I want to be given that chance, not be like, yeah, but. Mm. And that's when tapas changed.
Okay. So you went over to tapas. What was that experience like?
I went over to tapas. To this day, that's the best job I've had. The bosses, Franco and Alfredo, fantastic. And Franco gave me the opportunity to create stuff. So for the time I came there, I did a dish, gave it to Franco for dinner, you know? And he liked it, put it on the menu.
Okay.
Yeah, and then I kept doing that, and then I got promoted, and I got promoted again. And then by the time I left tapas, I was the head chef at tapas.
So you're head chef, you're able to create your own dishes. Why leave?
I was happy there, to be honest, but I still had the head chef, but Franco was still the exec. So even though I may put on 10 dishes as mine, people will never see it as Damian. Mm. They will always see it as Franco, right? Although maybe Damian the dish, but at the end of the day, it's Franco's dish. Mm. So, but I wasn't looking to leave, but I was approached with this project here. Mm-hmm. And I said, yeah, I take it. Time for Damian to be known.
Okay, now I'm going to go somewhere with this, right? They say, whoever they might be, they say that chefs can be notoriously kind of self-centered, arrogant, a bit prideful, they want to be known and all those kind of things. So when we come back, we're going to take a break. And you can think about that and tell me whether that is so and that kind of propels you, not in a negative way, but whether it propelled you to really step out when the opportunity came. All right? You can tell me that later. We'll be back right here on Breakfast in Barbados. Breakfast in Barbados.
L and there.
L and there.
L and there.
L and there. How do you L and there? Take a moment to L and there with your options of yago, fruits, and 0% fat yogurts made from real milk using real fruits.
Distributed by Supreme Distributors.
MIS spices have been flavoring the pots of Barbadians for over 25 years. Available island-wide at all leading supermarkets, MIS spices come in a wide variety of flavors, like black pepper, Cajun spice, bacon bits, crushed chili flakes, coriander powder, cumin powder, curry powder, basil leaves, celery salt, and blackened spice. Celebrity chefs and mixologists use MIS spices to enhance the flavor of their creations. MIS products, making it special for you. For you. For you. For you. For you.
My name is Nicole Knight. I'm a lecturer at the University of the West Indies, Cahill campus. I travel pretty often on my job, and so for conferences and so on, I travel during the summer. Value Vacations is the place to go. They're very efficient. If you want to have a holiday or if you have to plan business travel, I find that they're very efficient, very organized in the way that they do things. So I tend to go to them because I want hassle-free travel. And I find that they deliver that very easily.
Welcome back to Breakfast in Barbados, and we're at Cocktail Kitchen in St. Lawrence Gap in Christchurch with Chef Damian Leach. And I just asked you a question. I'm not letting you get away with it. Chefs are said to have big egos, you know, a bit arrogant and that kind of thing. Is that a part of... Oh, first of all, is that true?
I don't think that's true.
Of course
I mean, some of them are. I doubt it. Yeah. I wouldn't call myself arrogant or cocky, but...
Bit of an ego, though. I mean, no, as it relates to your... foodiness.
Well, I mean, you want your name out there. You want to be the best, but I mean, I'm not going to go around telling people I'm the best. I tell my wife, you know, I'd say, be like, yeah, greatest chef in Barbados. But I'm not going to tell people, though. I won't let people know that I'm thinking that, right? Which I don't think that.
So when that call came for you to, the opportunity came for you to start this project, Cocktail Kitchen, what was it that said, Damian, now is the time? You were comfortable, you liked where you were.
Yeah.
But something, what was it that said, go?
I guess maybe I just wanted a little bit of a change. I was at Tapas for 6 years. I was happy, but I don't know. It was a difficult decision for me, to be honest. But I just decided that I would take it, and the wife told me, you know, now it's time to get your name out there, you know. Yeah. She told me.
It's a big decision. Where you come from, okay, I work, I love what I do, yeah. I get paid. I don't have to sit down and think about
correct, you know,
anything
it was,
to this.
It was just comfortable, you know? Mm-hmm. Everything was just normal. Everything was just cool, you know?
Fine. Okay. Well, I'm going to get back to the whole cocktail kitchen and everything because I'm loving this space that you have. And I understand you have great plans because it's not going to be just the space that we're in. But,
yeah.
You know, I've been listening. Let's talk about getting to Taste of the Caribbean and becoming Caribbean Chef of the Year. Not just local Chef of the Year, which is still a big thing, Barbadian's Chef of the Year if you won that, but Caribbean Chef of the Year. Talk me through that process. What made you decide, I'm going to try this? Did somebody come to you and say, Damian, you should really go and do this thing?
I've actually wanted to make this Barbados team since I was going to Palmarine, actually. I wanted to make the Barbados team. You know, I wanted to have this cool jacket with Barbados all over it and my name on it, you know. And I tried out for the competition quite a few times, a lot. And I just wouldn't make it, but I was improving. First of all, competitions, I'm a shy person. Competitions, I don't do well in front of people. I get very nervous. So the first competition I did was horrible, but the next one was still horrible, but a little less horrible.
Because you're getting accustomed to
again,
the process.
Yes, so me as a person was becoming better, you know, I'm more comfortable with people. To this day, I'm still nervous at competitions, but it's not as bad. But, but I tried many, many years, and each year I said, this is my last year. If I don't make it, this is it, done with this year. But I just couldn't.
Was there any particular area that you found you fell down in regularly within the actual getting ready for the competition? Or being a part of the competition, I should say.
I guess with competition, there's a lot of points with the, you know, organization and just clean and have everything. Whereas in a kitchen, you're kind of, you know, not dirty, mm-hmm. but more free. But everything is, you know, exact, you know, for competition. Mm-hmm. There while you're cooking. So I think maybe it was falling out on that part. I mean, there were a few times I thought I could have made a team, but mm-hmm. I didn't.
But you came back and you kept trying until you did.
Yeah.
Tell me about getting ready for this particular one. I saw a lot of stuff on Facebook where you would actually have to present your dishes and all those kind of things. The competition seems to have really grown mm. over the years and changed, where you'd have to present this food and all that kind of stuff. Tell me about that.
Oh, do you want down here?
Mm-hmm.
Well, it was two rounds. It's a signature dish round, where you come up, you bring your own stuff, you have an idea, and then you have, I think it was an hour and a half or something, and you do it. And then they take the top 10 into the final. The final is the mystery basket now. So they would give you three proteins, I think it was, and a starch or something. And you got a community kitchen, and then you just come up with a dish for that. I think it was four dishes.
Okay. So when you actually hear, Damian, you made the team, how'd you feel?
Freaking out, because Michelle called me because I had the finals in the morning time, and we weren't supposed to get the results until the next day. And Michelle called me and told me. And I just got goosebumps still. It's crazy. But yeah, I was really, really excited when I got that phone call.
Wonderful, wonderful.
I called my wife immediately, and then I went to call my mom and my dad, and they found out already, because apparently my wife can call them a lot faster than I can call them. And then everyone else knew, but it was crazy.
So it was all celebration?
Yeah.
At least for a couple of days or so?
Yeah, okay. Yeah, for sure. I mean, I was at work that night. Mm. Service was fantastic. Nobody couldn't get me down. I don't care. 300 people that night. Waited doing foolishness. Like,
you were just happy. You know? You're like, whatever, world. Do whatever you want to do. So, but there comes a time where you have to come off of that high now because the hard work.
Yes.
What about the training process now as Team Barbados? You're working as a team now.
Yeah. Training was not easy at all. First of all, it took up a lot of time, and just when I made the team is when we started with here. So it two clashed. So where I was trying to be here, I trying to be at training. But it was hectic. But the team that I had, we got along really good. Like I work in any kitchen with that team I took out there.
Who were some of the people on your team?
We had Willis Griffith, Kurt Rupp, Ron Maynard. Nicholas Eiffel was a junior. Javon was pastry. Who else we had? We had Will War. Good guys though.
So how do you train? Because people are thinking, the average person would probably think, well, y'all are already chefs. What training do you need to do? How does that look when you're going as Team Barbados to Taste of the Caribbean? Preparing yourself, because you know somebody would hear, okay, we got Olympics coming up soon. Mm-hmm. You know, you got to run some whatever your discipline is. You got to do your exercise. You have to eat properly. You have to, you know, get your times better. But what does training look like for chefs and Team Barbados?
Well, I mean, one of the things is coming out with ideas. First of all, coming out with ideas. If you got this particular thing, what we do with it. But the big thing about training was, again, the same thing I was talking about, organization and timing and everything. Because, yeah, all of us on the team, we can cook. But those are the things where the points, no, we don't want to lose points on them. So we got to look, like, everything is just smooth. Everything is just clockwork, this, that, you know? And everything is clean.
So when y'all get on that plane and head off to Miami, were you confident? When you hit the ground there, were you confident?
When we left Barbados, I mean everybody was cool, you know. Mm-hmm. Nobody was nervous yet. It's just, you know, flying. You know? We do a little shopping the night we land, you know, mm-hmm. go Sawgrass or something. Mm-hmm. It's then after that, now the day after that, that nerves start kicking. You know, this is it. No, competition is here.
Seeing the other teams from different countries, was that nerve wracking, or you know people from other teams and you kind of greet each other, that kind of thing?
We were kind of greeting everybody. I mean, with the exception of a few, but most of the teams there were really cool guys, you know. Mm-hmm. I've actually added most of them on Facebook and Instagram since. Some cool guys, but nervous for sure, especially for me.
being a naturally nervous person. Thing. Okay. Competition time now.
Competition time. For my chef of the year one. Mm-hmm. I've never been nervous like that. I was outside because my team brings all my equipment and we're outside waiting. And I'm out there waiting. And I'm freaking out. I'm going through my head and saying, Damian, you see this here? Never again. I don't know what you put yourself through this here for. Never. You know, my wife, my mom and dad, they came there and my mom was kind of out there and my wife and I was just like, all right, cool, you know, just, I don't want to deal with none of y'all right now. This is me. I'm freaking out. I am freaking out.
Some people say they were in the zone. You were just freaking out.
Nah, I was just freaking out. I was over there. I was over there walking up and down, you know, just vaping. But yeah, and then I went in. And Frank, tell me when I told my team how I like to work. I like them to make enough support. Mm-hmm. I like them to make enough jokes. That's what I
accustomed to in the kitchen. Your
That's
tension.
My thing. I don't want you just shouting, yeah, Damian, let me go. I want you make jokes. I want you to talk foolishness. Mm-hmm. And that's exactly what they did. And they made a massive difference for that competition for me.
Okay. They were kind of like your driving force,
For sure, 100%.
Okay. What about your dish now that you prepared?
The dish that I prepared. I know people ask me this, it seems to take forever to ramble it off, but it is a smoked sweet potato and shrimp rolled in leek ash, spice braised eggplant, curry scented corn creme brulee, citrus coriander cream, papaya jelly, and Bajan marinated lamb.
Wow, that sounds really, really good. So how long does it take you to prepare that? What were your time we get, frames and your time limits, basically?
We get 2 hours.
For all of that?
4 dishes and then 10 tasting plates, I think it was. Mm-hmm. But the first hour, we're not allowed to cook, only stocks. We're not allowed to cook anything. We can prep everything, but nothing. We can't turn on the stove or nothing of that. Mm. The last hour, no, is when all the cooking has to come down. So if it was just 2 hours and we could think it would be all right because I could start cooking. But see, when it's just cooking out last hour. So I knew going into that was the thing. That we had to be moving once that time started.
I mean,
that was where the training came in.
There's more people, most people, if they give you 2 hours to cook normal rice and stew and macaroni, but you can get it done for, unless they tell you 2 hours, but the first hour is just prep. You can't cook anything.
Can't cook anything.
Okay, so you finished in between there, though, in that hour that you were cooking. Was there any point you thought to yourself, whoa, I don't think I got it. I don't think I can finish.
Because the time going in there was the biggest issue. We've been training on that, and the whole thing was saying, when you go, just move. So I was working on that, and I was going as fast as I can. And there was some kind of mix-up with the time. So when I heard, Chef Butcher shout and tell me that I had 15 minutes or something left, and I was like, shoot.
Yes, he was like, shoot.
And I was panicking, you know. I was like, all right, well, there's this here looking iffy here. No, uh-huh. Let me get this thing. And then he asked one of the judges at the time, and then he showed him out and said, it was all right, it's extra 10 minutes on top of that. Okay. And I was like, all right, cool. No, we bought any program here. Mm-hmm. No,
you're all done. It's finally finished. You got your 10 plates, 10 tasting plates.
10 tasting plates, and then the three main courses.
Oh my goodness, that's all done. It's finished. Mm. When you were actually finished, whether you obviously didn't know that you won. Mm. How did you feel when you actually got those plates out?
I actually felt good because I got what I wanted to get done. Mm-hmm. Like I was happy with it. I mean, yeah, I would have a few things. It wasn't 100% perfect, but I was fairly confident in the dish. Obviously, I wouldn't see what all the other chefs have done yet, and I wouldn't got any feedback. But as I came out, and then, you know, guys from the other teams were telling me, yeah, that looked real good, and then they had tasting plates, and everybody was giving me, you know, good feedback. Mm-hmm. And then the judges later on that evening gave me their feedback, and that was...
So when you found out that you won Caribbean Chef of the Year, tell me about when you heard.
Well, we were at the awards, and the Chef of the Year one is towards the end of the awards dinner, so that dinner's nerve-wracking too, huh? You out there standing up like, shh, I know getting out here, but that there. And then they called out, that's how it works, you get the gold. So they had two other guys that had got gold in the category, and then out of that, they picked the chef of the year.
Right.
So I would have went up for my gold, and I was coming down. So, you know, all my team, you know, they're going mad and everything. So I gone up the stage, and they come down, And then that's when they start to announce Andy Chef of the Year. So I'm still walking, I don't know who it is. And then they say, you know, Barbados, Damian Leach. From there on, the Barbados team came, lifted me up, took me on the stage, and it was wild.
Wow, fantastic time for you.
Yeah.
Well, congratulations again, Damian.
Thank you. We're
going to be talking about Cocktail Kitchen, and you're going to be preparing something for us as well. What are you preparing for us today?
I'm going to prepare the same dish that I won the competition with.
Some lamb. Like it. We'll be back on Breakfast in Barbados. We're going into the kitchen right here at Cocktail Kitchen with Chef Damian Leach.
Breakfast in Barbados.
Are you in the mood for West Indian food? Or maybe you think you like a nice drink? It's the Caribbean Cooking Channel. Caribbean Cooking Channel. From island to island, something for everyone. Taste the recipes from the West Indies. It's the Caribbean Cooking Channel. Caribbean Cooking Channel.
L and Bear.
L and Bear.
L and Bear.
L and Bear. How do you, L and Bear? Take a moment to L and Bear with your options of yago, fruits, and 0% fat yogurts made from real milk using real fruits.
Distributed by Supreme Distributors. Over the years, MIS has been known for its high-quality food and flavoring products. And now we bring you MIS Essences. We offer a wide variety of exciting and unique flavors like almond, cinnamon, strawberry, banana, pineapple, coconut, lemon, vanilla, and mixed essence. Now you will have all the essence you need when baking your cake, preparing your desserts, or mixing a refreshing cocktail. Available island-wide at all leading supermarkets, make it special with MIS Essences today.
Are the most affordable source of protein around. They contain choline to help with your memory, as well as vitamin A, B, D, and K. Eggs promote healthy hair and nails because of their high sulfur content and wide array of vitamins and minerals. Star Chick eggs are very, very tasty. Be wise and follow the star, I say. Eat Star Chick eggs each and every day.
Star Chick.
We're back with Breakfast in Barbados, Chef Damian Leach, inside the kitchen of Cocktail Kitchen, brand new restaurant on St. Lawrence Gap. And he's going to be sharing with us the dish that made him a winner, Caribbean Chef of the Year, no doubt. So Damian, tell us the dish again.
Well, we have a Bajan marinated lamb loin, and that's going with a smoked sweet potato and shrimp, rolled in leek ash, spice braised eggplant, citrus coriander cream, and curry scented corn creme brulee.
That sounds like a lot of hard work. Okay, so you already marinated the lamb. What kind of things did you use in your marinade?
In my marinade, I like to use Bajan seasoning, Bajan pepper sauce, fresh herbs, thyme, marjoram, garlic, cumin, and It's a big no-no from where we went to school, but a little bit of ketchup.
That's the ketchup.
We love ketchup. We love ketchup.
It
works. We gotta put it, you know?
You're putting your own twist on it. So what do you do now with this lamb?
We're gonna put this on the grill and get a nice char, and then we'll finish it in the oven.
Okay. So do I need to move out of your way?
No, you should be good.
So how long are you gonna leave this on?
Just so it gets a little char on it, you know? That's the flavor. Yeah, the char, all the seasoning, get a little mark.
Why is this char thing so important? You see a lot of people doing that. Oh, put it in, let it get a little char, turn it on all sides, then you finish it in the...
That's when all the seasonings and the sugar in it, and they start to caramelize on the meat. Mm-hmm.
Does it add more to the flavor?
It adds flavor and it adds to the appearance as well.
Okay. So that's a pretty big piece of lamb.
Yeah. Obviously, we're not going to use all of this. This is a few portions here. Mm-hmm. But we're going to eat it because we have a big film crew.
Yeah.
So we're going to cook all.
I'm sure. I'm sure they will not refuse. So you get these nice grill marks. I find this is a technique, you know. You don't just do this at home unless you know what you're doing.
Well, the crisscross is easy.
And we have this wonderful lamb loin. And this one is Compliments Hotel Food Supplies.
Yes, that's correct. This came from them.
Man, I tell you, it's looking good enough to eat right now, but of course, we know inside is still raw.
Yeah, so we can put that in there.
Putting it into the oven now. So how long does that go in there?
For this size, it'll probably be 15 minutes or so.
Okay.
We'll check it out too.
So 15 minutes or 20 minutes or so to loveliness, right?
But see, I don't ever like to say with a meat, it's going to take 15 minutes or 20 minutes. Mm-hmm. I always just test it, because depending on how hot the oven is, how fat it is, so we'll see. I'll just keep testing it, but I would figure around 15 minutes.
You neglected to tell me something. You own another restaurant.
Yes.
Tell me about this other restaurant.
It's called The Mill. Mm-hmm. It's located up at Kenwood, up at Do It Best and Dwellings and that kind of thing. Casual place, but we do a lot of homemade burgers, homemade bread, fish platters, steak platters. We have a lamb burger that's really popular. So we made that also.
I thought I knew most places, but I have never heard of The Mill. So you know I have to come and check. Especially since you have the burger rivalry. Now it makes sense.
With the burger rivalry
with your dad. Okay, I see. So are you going to keep The Mill going as you develop Cocktail Kitchen?
Yeah.
All right. Well, tell me about the process of bringing Cocktail Kitchen to where it is now, because you look just about finished.
Yeah.
You know, and getting the right location, one, why did you choose here? And then the process to the point where you are ready to open.
Well, I mean, the other guys, the owners, they just got the spot. But I mean, this spot has always been one of my favorite spots in the Gap. This when Cafe Sol had it ever since on that wall, you know, it's a big drinking crowd.
People
like to watch people.
Yeah, that's true.
That's what people like to do.
And the Gap is always busy.
Yeah.
So
that's where it is. We got some final touches to do outside now, but we started testing it in the kitchen. Mm-hmm. And so next week we'll be fully ready for the public.
So for a gentleman who, I'm going back to what you talked about a little earlier, when you first started at the Cliff, one of your challenges, you loved the experience, but one of your challenges was you needed to see more happening as it related to menu.
Yeah.
Then you went on to tapas, you were able to be creative where the menu was concerned, and now you have here. What is the menu going to look like, or is it going to change on a regular basis?
I plan on changing it probably every 6 months. I will change it completely. I'll still run specials probably every week. I'll put on something different. Also, the staff that I picked, it's a small crew. I have a sous chef, Lindsay, and I took two guys from Pomerina. I actually went to Pomerina and talked to some of my old chefs and said, I want two guys that are now coming out of the associate's degree that are good. I don't necessarily care how they did in social studies or the other things they had to do. I want to know the ones that were strong in the kitchen. So I bought those guys on, and especially because of how I was at the Cliff, and I felt that I was stuck at one point. I told them that I don't want them to come and stay here. I want them to move around. Although they're youngsters, I want them to come over here and, you know, come and touch meat with me and learn. I want when they leave here, just like when I left Tapas and I say that's the best place I ever worked, the best bosses, I want them to speak that of Cocktail Kitchen and myself as well.
So how would you describe yourself as a boss or a potential boss, having the mill, now here, cocktail kitchen, what kind of boss are you?
I think I'm a pretty cool boss, to be honest. But most bosses think that. But mm-hmm. I like to have fun with people, you know. Mm-hmm. I find people work better when they're having fun. If I'm miserable, you guys don't want to come work, and I'm like, shh, I'll get it to Damian again. No, he can crawl about something. Mm-hmm. But no, I like to have fun. But at the same time, yeah, I want you to do your work and be efficient in what you do. But let me talk some foolishness at the same time, you know. And then play a little music in here, you know. A little stiffy in here, you know.
Don't start. Some start sticking in your head and all kinds. Wrong. Anyway. So you describe yourself as kind of like a fun boss and stuff like that, but yeah. As you said, the serious side has to come into play. In your kitchen, in Chef Damian's kitchen, what are some of the things that are definitely expected? Your people can expect, this is what I want, this is how I like it done, it has to be this time or...
Yeah, I want, one of the things that really has me is lateness. That's always been a problem. My father was always on time. Actually, if I'm running late, like probably because of the wife, she's sticking out the show, I get very anxious. And
he's in trouble. Mayday, man down.
So I like you to be on time, like all the time. I mean, yeah, it's gonna happen, but I'm a man. If I got somewhere to go at 8 o'clock, I can be there at 7:30.
Okay.
Most of my interviews, I get there an hour early.
Respect.
Right, but that's my thing. And if I show you a dish, I want that dish to be that. If you think it could change, come to me and say, why we don't add a little thing, you know? Yeah, maybe that would be a good idea. But don't change the dish and send it out. Or leave something out, because everything on that dish is supposed to complement one another. Mm-hmm. So don't say, oh, I ordered that day, but it can still go. I don't deal with that.
Okay. What can patrons expect when they walk through the doors of Cocktail Kitchen in another week or so?
The service is what we really focus on, not just the food. We want it to be a real, you know, fun vibe and just cool, you know. Mm. Very, very casual, but the food is gonna be, I call it casual fine dining. But fun. The staff we have there are supposed to be smiley and thing, not just like, yeah, can I have you lamb or go along? Nah, I want to talk with you and have a good time, you know.
But how do you monitor that? I mean, I've had some dining experiences here in Barbados, in different countries in the world, and let's face it, the world is becoming a very small place.
Yeah.
Even if you don't actually taste food, there's so many people, there's so many foodies watching food channels, and they're watching all the elements of what it means to go to a restaurant or to own a restaurant or something like that. How do you monitor how your patrons are treated and keep that quality up if you are in here running the kitchen?
That's obviously one of the challenges that we face, especially in the beginning. Because right now I have to be here at all times for the start. I go there, but we have a confident bar manager out there that oversees out there, Kadeem. Mm-hmm. So he's a good guy. And the waiters and waitresses, again, a real good vibe from. I work off a lot of vibes. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So if I have an interview and I'm not really vibing with you, I understand you'll be nervous because I'm a nervous fella. Mm-hmm. But I can still sense vibes, right? And we got staff with good vibes.
Ah, yes, vibes. So what's the vibe? It better be good.
It's a good vibe.
Well said. All right, so we're waiting on our lamb.
Yeah, we just give it a quick check here now.
Gonna check it.
Yeah, we still got time for that. Turn it up a little.
Now, one of the things that fascinates me as you watch chefs cooking and getting things ready, for a piece of lamb like that, it's a pretty big piece.
Yeah.
But you know, in Barbados, not just Barbados, people in general who are not trained and stuff like that, you're gonna stab it with something.
No, you don't want to cut it. No, you don't want to.
How do you know that it's done? You know, because there's little things like that. I love the idea that I'm able to come to some place like Cocktail Kitchen and see a menu and think, oh, I'll try that. But I also like the idea of being able to go home and try something, but sometimes you don't know how to do certain things. So how do you know when a piece of meat is cooked? How would you teach me to
honestly
do that?
I don't think it can really be taught like that. It's something that how I learned is I would touch, because we do a lot of touch for the temperatures. Mm-hmm. You know, see how I just had the tongs just now and I gave it a little thing. So it's all about feel. Mm-hmm. So I can't say, well, it's just feel. You would have to come and feel it every time.
So
I think You get
the experience
you get
doing
a pass
it.
Of it. That's the only way. But
okay.
Meats is one of those things in the kitchen that's the hardest part. That's usually the last part
that you learn.
You know, so you start off in your different ranks, and then meat would be the last. It's the most difficult. Once you learn meat, then
wow. I tell you, because that's still something that gets me. So I tend to cook smaller portions, so I'm more confident. And another thing I wanted to ask you, because I find most chefs think that you're being sacrilegious when you talk about those things. Still, let's face it, still in Barbados, when people talk about eating meat in Barbados, we do not do rare. Seldom do we do rare. Medium rare. Well done. As a chef, when somebody comes and says, I want my meat well done, what does that do to you?
I start to not really care about the dish as much. If you order well done, you've now destroyed it. I wish that I was as arrogant and cocky as you think some chefs are, that I could be like, I go there and be like, nah, left, left. Order it properly or left. That's an expensive piece of meat that you have there and you're going to just cook it to the thing. I could have thrown it in fryer if you want to.
Oh my goodness. It never fails when chefs hear well done meat. Their face changes from real happy to what?
And then some people order it well done and they go there and they say, well, this is tough, this thing. But it's you that order it, so not me. It's well done, what do you expect?
What is the best way to eat a piece of meat?
Piece of meat, it all depends. Steak or something like that, medium rare is really good. I find lamb I go more to the medium side. Because it tends to be a little chewy, mm-hmm. but medium rare, approaching medium, but meat, medium rare for sure.
Okay, I just saw your whole body change with this well done thing. We will not be coming to Cocktail Kitchen and ordering meat well done, but this is where we're going to take a break. We'll be back with Chef Damian Leach here at Cocktail Kitchen in St. Lawrence Gap, right here on Breakfast in Barbados.
Breakfast in Barbados.
L and Bear.
L and Bear.
L and Bear.
L and Bear. How do you, L and Bear? Take a moment to L and Bear with your options of yago, fruits, and 0% fat yogurts made from real milk using real fruits.
Distributed by Supreme Distributors.
MIS spices have been flavoring the pots of Barbadians for over 25 years. Available island-wide at all leading supermarkets, MIS spices come in a wide variety of flavors, like black pepper, Cajun spice, bacon bits, crushed chili flakes, coriander powder, cumin powder, curry powder, basil leaves, celery salt, and blackened spice. Celebrity chefs and mixologists use MIS spices to enhance the flavor of their creations. MIS products, making it special for you. For you. For you. For you. For you.
My name is Nicholas Vaughan and I am a Spanish and French teacher. So because I teach languages, I had the idea that we should really and truly see many parts of the world where those languages are spoken. With our tour to Barcelona in particular, I remember them making sure that the airport transfers at London, those were organized. However, that morning in question, we landed in London really, really early and the bus was not there. So what we did, we called Valley Vacations. This is like the equivalent of about 2 a.m. Barbados time. And quickly they got hold of the bus driver. The two of them communicated and then we were able to find him with great ease. They sent their representatives along and we were very, very grateful. I highly recommend Valley Vacations for anyone who's looking for a travel agent. If you want any company to look after all of your travel needs, Valley Vacations is the one for you. I highly recommend it.
Indian food. Or maybe you think you like a nice drink. It's the Caribbean Cooking Channel. Caribbean Cooking Channel. From island to island, something for everyone. Taste the recipes from the West Indies. It's the Caribbean Cooking Channel. Caribbean Cooking Channel.
Breakfast in Barbados.
We're back with Chef Damian Leach here at Cocktail Kitchen, and he's going to be plating his winning dish, the dish that got him Caribbean Chef of the Year. Damian, let's go through this dish again. First of all, what's this?
This is a citrus coriander cream. So it's lemon zest, a little lemon juice, fresh coriander, and some aloe vera cream.
Okay.
Just blend it together. Here we have a papaw jelly. It's basically like a salsa that I set in agar and rolled in this shape, just to give it a little a different appearance, no? Rather than just a salsa.
Yeah, you gotta take it up a notch when you're dealing with this kind of competition.
Yes, for sure.
And the amount of talent that you have at Taste of the Caribbean as well.
Yes, guys are coming hard. All right, so first things, we're gonna have our sweet potato and shrimp. It's smoked sweet potato and shrimp with leek ash. Just to give it that little charred taste, it goes back with the smoke, like a roast breadfruit.
Mm. Kind of looks like one, with a tail.
Yeah. Next, we're gonna have our spice braised eggplant.
I find eggplant gets a bad rap in Barbados, but eggplant is really, really nice.
I'm not really a big fan of eggplant, to be honest.
It, love it.
But because it's a difficult vegetable, and not a lot of people are mad about it, I decided to use it.
I absolutely love eggplant. I think I fell even more in love. I went somewhere and had a lasagna. But a vegetarian lasagna.
Like a parmigiana.
He actually called it a lasagna because he actually used lasagna noodles as well.
So oh,
it
yeah?
It wasn't just the eggplant parmigiana. It was different. But he also used eggplant layers. So I thought that was really, really powerful. Tastes good. What are we doing here?
This is our curry-scented corn creme brulee. So again, I roasted off the corn, the onions, curry, different spices. Aloe vera cream and a little bit of agar to set it.
Torch!
Yeah, of course, we can't have a creme brulee without the famous.
How good that smells. Just caramelizing, that smells so good.
Okay,
that is
stick on
there. Ah, so before the caramel sets.
Yeah,
this is a piece of plantain?
That's sweet potato.
Is it? Oh, I thought it was plantain. And this beautiful piece of lamb. And this is how you like to see your lamb done.
Yes, correct. Let's have a piece there. And then we have a little papaya salsa jelly.
And this one.
Hmm?
What's this?
This is a sauce. Reduced down from the bones of the lamb. The herbs and everything. This goes with the lamb. The roasted pepper emulsion. Just put a little bit here. Then we just have a little micro greens. Color. That's it.
Wow, that looks really, really good. Well, I'm about to tuck into Chef Damian Leach's winning dish. Damian, I love this presentation. This is what you call a sexy plate.
Thank you. The plate actually came from Utopia. They had given me this plate to use in Miami, so.
Okay.
But they have some really good stuff over there in the showroom.
It is nice, I love it. All right, so what do you suggest I try first? Since this is your winning dish.
If it was me, I would go straight to Milan.
Fine.
But the curry corn crumblet, and you told me that you like seafood, so maybe you could go with that and the corn crumblet.
Right.
And but they all should work together.
So you told me I need to try all of this together.
Together.
So I need to tip this bad boy over.
Yeah, you probably just cut straight through the middle because that shrimp actually goes straight down the middle also.
Okay. Yeah, sure, again, nice.
Ooh. You should be able to get the smoke coming through everything. Mm-hmm.
Wow, nice and smoky. It's a little sweet, but still savory as well. And then you can taste that shrimp coming through there. I'm going to go with your lamb. Even though you said I should have gone with that first, I'm going to go second, all right?
Yeah, that I would taste with the actual creme brulee.
The actual creme brulee.
The corn creme brulee.
Mm-hmm. But Damian.
You nervous with the person cooking your food watching you eat it?
Yeah, very.
Wait, can't say nothing bad.
He really doesn't know me. I mean, of course not, Damian. All right, you win. And that creme brulee, nice sweet, crunchy caramel at the top. Oh.
And then the natural sweetness from the corn.
Yeah. That's nice. Well, you know I love eggplant, so I've got to try this. Wow. Well, Chef Damian, I can see why you are Caribbean Chef of the Year. This is absolutely delicious. It's creative. It's beautiful because they say we eat with our eyes.
It's true.
It is absolutely beautiful. So congratulations and thank you so much for joining us on Breakfast in Barbados.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining us on Breakfast in Barbados. We are right here, brand new restaurant, Cocktail Kitchen in St. Lawrence Gap. You also have another restaurant, The Mill, and that's in?
Kingwood.
Okay.
Well, by Do It Best and Dwellings.
And that's in St. Thomas.
Yes.
Right. So thank you so much. I'm Carol Toppin. Bye-bye.
Morning's here.